This, then, was how Superintendent Mooney saw the position at present from a study of the reports on his desk. What he would have to find out at once was the whereabouts of Matt Caldwell and Frank Littlewood about the time of the murder of Sir Robert Boniface. It would be necessary, incidentally, to find out what the relationship between Caldwell and Littlewood was. Did they know one another? Was there any possibility of a plot between them? He would also have to find out why Sir Robert had changed his mind about seeing his sister on Saturday. Again, where did Sir Robert go in the afternoons when he used to drive himself? This might have no direct bearing on the murder, but it might help to piece together the daily routine of the millionaire baronet, for Sir Robert's movements on the day of his murder would have, of course, to be established, and then those scratches on the back of the blue limousine would have to be explained. Mooney did not know why, but those scratches worried him. He decided that he would himself examine them carefully, and he rang up the Hampstead police to make sure that the blue limousine, which was still standing where it had been found 2 days ago, should not be moved till he had seen it. The case seemed quite simple so far. A little too simple, the superintendent muttered, feeling suddenly a wave of pessimism coming over him. He knew too well how impressions created by the study of documents were apt suddenly to change entirely once one came face to face with the living people about whom documentary evidence conveyed so false an impression. In his practice of tracking down criminals, he had also learned that the unexpected was always round the corner, that a chance find, which apparently had no connection with the investigation, might in the end turn out to be the connecting link without which the whole collected evidence made no sense, and that a faulty alibi, or sometimes the entire absence of an alibi, was as little a sign of guilt as a foolproof alibi was a sign of innocence.